Hello and welcome back to the Forms for SharePoint video guide. In our previous videos, we have explored how to connect and work with SharePoint sites, lists, and libraries, how to create form sets, custom routing, and more. If you haven't seen those videos yet, I have linked the playlist in the description. And in today's video, we're going to take a closer look at three unique controls available from Plumsail Forms for SharePoint: InkSketch, DataTable, and Likert Scale. They bring in essential functionality that is missing from the default SharePoint forms. So let's get started. And we are starting in the service request form opened in the Plumsail Forms for SharePoint app. I have already pre-designed it and added existing fields from the SharePoint list. We have the following ones: request number, date, requested by, and department. So now let's add the data table control. You might be asking, what is exactly a data table control? Well, it is a dynamic table that is designed to add and store data in a single SharePoint field within the same list. For example, you can use it as a product catalog, or in our case, it will be a list of services with cost and description. If you're wondering what is exactly the difference between data table and list of library controls, as they seem similar. While list of library control displays and stores each record as a separate SharePoint list item, and it supports all SharePoint column types as well as formatting. While data table is designed for a more basic use case of storing data in one SharePoint field, and it cannot pull data from a different list. And now we can add as many columns as we need in the data table control, and the users will be able to add entries to this table. Here you can change the name of the table or hide it. I'll go with hide. And now we can add a couple more columns by clicking on the plus button. When a column is selected, it can be moved from left to right and from right to left. I can also make a column required to be filled out by clicking on the asterisk. And of course, you can delete a column. And let's look on the right-hand side. Here we can change the name, width, and title of the selected column, and there's property to mark it as required as well. And the main feature is that you can choose the type of column. So here we have string or text, number, currency, boolean, date, and dropdown. Let's keep the type of the first column as string and change the title to service requested. I'll make it required and set width to 275 pixels. Next, let's rename column 2 to quantity. We'll make it required and change type to number. After choosing number type, we get additional properties: minimum and maximum value limits, precision to specify the number of decimals, activate percent format, and spin buttons. If you switch spin buttons on, then a user can enter or edit the number using up and down buttons located right next to the number in the table. Let's turn it on so we can see how it looks in the form view later. Spin step defines the interval for adjusting the current value when up and down arrows are used. We'll leave it for now at 1 and come back to this feature later in the video. And also let's adjust the width to 150. Column 3, let's rename it to cost, and the type will switch to currency. Again, we get the same minimum and maximum limits, precision, spin buttons, and you can change the default dollar sign to another currency sign. And I'll set the width to 100. Column 4 will rename to priority, and let's switch type to dropdown. In the options property, we can specify urgent, normal, and low. You can also allow users to add values and allow selection of multiple values in the dropdown. Now let's add a Boolean type column and we'll name it done. So when an agent completes a request, it can be marked as done. I'll set column width to 50. And the last column will be date type. I'll rename it to date requested and set width to 150. Great, each column is now customized and represents a different format type. Now let's look again at the general settings of the data table control. As with other controls, you can adjust alignment, number of columns, and padding. Under general settings, you can change title and name, make the control required, and adjust the width. And you can choose whether you want a new line to be added at the top or bottom of the table and where to place the delete button, first or last. Up next is probably the most important property, Save To. It ensures that data table is saved to a SharePoint field. Here we have an option to save it to a new field or to an existing multi-line plain text field. Let's save it to a new field. I'll click on Add New, and we'll call it Service Details. Click Save. Next, we get an option to activate read-only mode, and there's also a formatting field. Formatting contains a JSON object that defines how values are displayed in the list view. You can change the order of the columns, remove columns from the list view, or change their titles. In the title section, we can change font size and color, make it bold or italic. I think we're done customizing the data table, so let's save the form and see how it looks in SharePoint. And we're now SharePoint list, so let's create a new item. Great, this is our data table control, so let's add a new request. For example, replace external camera. And in the quantity column next to the number, we have up and down arrows. That's the spin buttons that we have activated in the Forms for SharePoint app. You can either click on them or use your keyboard. And the number changes in increments of 1. And if we set spin step to 5 or 10, then the number will be changed in increments of 5 or 10, respectively. Now let's save the item and see how the data table control is displayed in the list view. Fantastic! The table with all the entered data is displayed in the list under one column. And now let's add ink sketch control to our form. I'll rename the tab to Signature and drag and drop the control. This control is perfect for collecting handwritten signatures or even drawings, diagrams, schemes, or notes. Let's change the name to Please Sign Here. Great, now we can make further adjustments in the settings on the right. Let's set alignment to left and add padding. Title and name already changed. We can switch out the layout and let's turn on the required property so a user won't be able to submit the form without signing it first. And we can expand the width and height of this control so users have enough space to leave a signature. Color property is responsible for the ink color, so let's change it to match the color used across the form. To do this, we can copy and paste the hex code used in the grid container. We will make it darker, but keep it in the same tone. And again, we need to make sure to save this control to a SharePoint field. I'll add a new one and call it Signature. And in this section, we can adjust the width of the title, its font size, and we can change the color to match the rest of the titles. We're all done adjusting this control, so let's save the form and see how it looks in SharePoint. First, I'll refresh the page. And here's our new column, Signature. So let's edit an existing item. And we can see that ink sketch control is present right here. So let's sign the form. Click Save. Great. And as you can see, the signature is visible in the list view as well. Next control we're going to look at is Likert Scale. Likert Scale is perfect for questionnaires and survey forms. So let's open a different SharePoint list. This one is Feedback Survey List. I have created it as a follow-up to the service request list we have worked with earlier. This will be a follow-up survey sent after the service request is completed. I have already created a few SharePoint fields, full name, service, date of service, and additional notes. Now let's go back to the Forms for SharePoint app. I have already partially designed the form and added existing fields from SharePoint list. Now let's add Likert Scale control. As you can see, it has default values to give you an idea and space to experiment with control settings. As we looked at the previous controls, we get grid cell settings, which allows us to set alignment, columns width, and padding. In general settings, we can rename the control, but since this property is not visible on the form, we can leave it as is. Let's make this control required, as the form's main purpose is to collect feedback. Type property has multiple options to choose from. Let's see how they are different from one another. The first one is radio. It allows you to select only one option from the list of answers. Next is checkbox. It allows you to select one or more options. String allows you to write a comment for each answer. Number type, as the name suggested, lets you enter a number. Drop-down type gives an option to select the answer from the predefined list. So let's pick radio. In questions property, you can add a list of your questions. Each one should be on a new line. Let's change the questions that we have here. The width property defines the width of the control in pixels. If you leave it blank, the control takes up the entire available width in the current grid cell. The answer should be entered on a new line as well. Finally, let's save our control to the SharePoint list. I'll create a new column, feedback. There's also an option to turn on the read-only mode. We have seen formatting property in data table control settings earlier. It is a property that contains a JSON object that defines how data is displayed in the list view. Here you can change question values and their order. Now let's save the form and see how it works in SharePoint. I have already refreshed the page, and here we have our feedback column. So let's create a new item and fill out the survey. Click Save. Amazing, we can see all the data entered in the feedback survey in the list view. And how are controls like Likert Scale or Signature actually displayed in the SharePoint list view? The field customizers make it possible. They're added by the designer and play an important role so that the controls like DataTable, Signature, and Likert Scale are displayed correctly in the SharePoint list view. If they are deleted, then the default view of the corresponding SharePoint columns is restored, though it does not affect other column settings. So let's see what happens if I delete one of the customizers, for example, the Likert Scale. Now let's check the SharePoint list. And as you can see, we have gibberish instead of the Likert scale. But don't worry, if we go back to the designer app and save the form again, the customizers are restored automatically. If you'd like to get more ideas how to use DataTable, InkSketch, and Likert Scale controls, especially how to use data submitted through these controls and process it in Power Automate, I have linked to a great video by an amazing expert in SharePoint and Power Automate, Anya. If you have any questions or would like us to cover a specific feature from the Forms for SharePoint app, leave a comment below. We have one more video coming out in this guide series, so make sure to subscribe and turn on notifications to not miss it. Thank you for watching and see you soon.